episode 1559, My Strength is My Story with Ryan Hall. Run the mile you're in.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a
stop sign, watching. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have an Olympian in the house. It's time to get your running shoes on because we are going to run the mile that you're in. You're going to fall in love with Ryan. Let's go. Get ready. For those of you who are brand new to Create You Now, friends and family of Ryan's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and to sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy, Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Well, I cannot wait to share with you and have you listen to Ryan. You are absolutely going to love him and his story. However, we did have a few technical issues, but it is still going to be one. You just may have to turn up the volume just a little bit because Ryan shares his heart. He talks about his faith-based coaching, what it was for him to start running and literally opening up his hands and saying, Lord, use me. Show me the way. And with all of that, his failures when he was running in the Beijing Olympics, we go through it all. And ultimately, we talk about the gold medal that he's running for. You'll have to stay tuned. So without further ado, let's welcome in Ryan Hall. Run the mile you're in. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have an Olympian in the house and an American record holder. Oh yes, I feel a little intimidated today. We are welcoming in Ryan Hall. He is a husband of 13 years to his beautiful wife, Sara, and the father to their four precious daughters adopted from Ethiopia. However, you may recognize Ryan's name from the 2008 and 2012 Summer Olympic Games. He represented the United States of America as a marathon runner. Ryan is also the American record holder for the half marathon. Get these numbers, 59:43. Yes, that's 59 minutes and 43 seconds. I'd be like 2 hours. And has the fastest marathon time ever run by an American with his time of 2:04. When he's not running after his gals, Ryan is coaching and speaking, and now he can add author to his list of many accomplishments with his brand new book, Run the Mile You're In, Finding God in Every Step. Time to get your running shoes on. Welcome, my friend and brother in Christ. How are you, Ryan?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me on your show.
Well, I am absolutely thrilled and delighted. A little intimidated, like I said before, but it's in a good way. My heart is just palpitating, and I cannot wait to dive into your story.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
Well, in your book, we're going to get into it, but I first want to ask you, what brings you joy?
Ooh, that's a great question. I like that question. There's a lot of things that bring me joy. One thing that really brings me joy is just laughing. Like, I'm just kind of like a silly person in general. Like, my kids are always laughing at me. And that's kind of like, I just love trying to make them laugh, you know? So I'll kind of like do whatever it takes to get them laughing. But it's just, it's such good medicine. It just changes atmospheres and just makes life fun and enjoyable.
Oh, that's awesome. And with four girls and your wife, I'm just saying we've got to say some extra prayers for you with all that estrogen building in that house.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And you have two dogs too, right?
Yeah, three dogs now.
Oh, three.
One boy. So at least we do have, but the boy is fixed, so it doesn't really count. I'm the only source of testosterone from the male.
Oh, dear Gussie. Okay, I'm on my knees right now. I'm just going to add you to my daily prayer list. I'm just saying. Oh, well, some people would think as an Olympian and American record holder, you came out of the womb running, but that's not how it started for you.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because I didn't write about this in the book, but my dad, he actually used to do that when I was an infant and a baby, and they'd change my diapers. He'd always take my legs and go run, 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 and like do the running motion. So I don't know, maybe it wasn't quite in the womb, but shortly thereafter, I actually forgot about that story. But yes, no, you're right. I did not enjoy running as a kid growing up, playing baseball, basketball, and football, and wanted to be a professional baseball player. That was kind of my childhood dream. And, you know, all that changed one day when I was 13 years old and going down to a basketball game, my hometown in Big Bear Lake in Southern California. And that's when God kind of just planted a little seedling of a desire to try and run around the lake, which was 15 miles, still is 15 miles. And went home, told my dad what I wanted to do, and I was so grateful that he didn't just like be like, son, that is not a good idea, like most people do not run 15 miles for their first run. But rather than doing that, like I probably would do to my girls now, he said, you know, like if that's what you feel like you're hearing, that's what you want to do, like let's do it together. So we both, you know, put on our running shoes the next weekend. I put on my basketball shoes. He was a runner, so he had running shoes. And embarked on a very, very long, super painful, super slow, 15-mile journey around the lake. And that was kind of the launching point for the next 20 years of my career.
Wow. Well, what did God reveal to you in that run?
Yeah, it was mainly at the end of the run where it kind of the revelation came. And I always like to tell people, like, if you're ever desperate to hear God and you're just having a hard time, you know, my advice to you, what I've personally experienced is I'm a lot better at hearing God when I'm physically exhausted. It just kind of, like, quiets my mind even more so. Like, it's great to, like, get by yourself in your room or out on a hike or something. But when you're by yourself and you're physically exhausted, it just becomes very, at least for me personally, very easy to hear from God. So that's what happened to me. I finished my run, stumbled through the front door, straight onto the couch, and I felt like God was telling me, you know, I'd given you a gift to run with the best guys in the world, and I gave you that gift so you can help other people. And so that was kind of, yeah, the vision of that I fell back on over and over and over again, because my journey was not linear up the whole time. It was very up and down, and there was actually a lot more failures than successes. So I can't tell you how many times I kind of wanted to give up and was like, I'm through with running, like I'm so sick of all this struggle, you know, it's so hard and all the ups and downs, I just want to stop. But I would reflect back and be like, have I accomplished that vision I feel like God gave me to run with the best guys in the world and to help other people? And if the answer is no, I need to keep moving forward.
Wow. And you continued on that journey. I mean, you started at 13, but it took you way into just a few years back when you officially retired.
Yeah, I retired at age 33. So full 20 years.
Wow. That's a long time running.
It was. I covered a lot of ground in that time.
Have you ever calculated how many runs, as in the actual races, not your practice and training runs, but your actual races, how many miles that has?
I have not, no. That'd be an interesting calculation. If anyone out there wants to go online and try and figure that out, let me know. I'd be curious.
Yeah, I can only imagine. I mean, with half marathons, and then when you started running marathons, I mean, because you didn't start out, right, Ryan, running marathons at the very beginning.
No. And in fact, I never thought I'd run a marathon as a professional athlete. I really wanted to be a miler. That was kind of my goal. And what I focused on collegiately during my time at Stanford was mainly the 800 and 1500 my first couple years. And then I gradually moved up to the 5K. And really, I wrote about this in my book a little bit, like this idea of like kind of opening up my hands and like being directed by like the giftedness that God had placed inside me, because I was so stubborn about being a miler and trying to run a fast mile time that I wasn't open to trying other races. Like there's a real sense of like pride, you know, of like I am a miler and I'm not gonna let anyone else tell me differently, when really like God designed me to like run half marathons and marathons. Like that's what I was built for. And so it took years and years for me to just open up my hands and be like, you know what, if I can't be a miler and I'm meant to do longer stuff, like I'm open to God's leading in that area of my life. And when I did that, things just really started to click and fall in place almost immediately, compared to when I was trying to focus on the track and running shorter races and really like running up against a lot of roadblocks.
It's interesting how when we go against the grain, not really that we're meaning to, but going against what God has truly designed us, how many uphill battles we tend to fight versus when we're playing his game of life, it's an incredible ride.
Right. I know. I can only imagine, like, him as a father, like, when he sees us, like, you're saying, going against the grain, just being like, you're making things so hard on yourself. Like, just trust me.
Well, speaking of dad, you and your dad had a very interesting summer ritual, and I found it very kind of like, wow, I want to do this with my children, actually. And that included a wheelbarrow, cement, and a shovel.
Yes. Yeah, so every summer we'd go into the backyard and mix up some fresh concrete, and we'd dig a hole, and we'd pour a little slab, and we'd both write our goals in the cement. And it's just really powerful to hold each other accountable to those goals. And it wasn't so much of, like, these goals have to happen, but it was more like the pursuit of the goal. That's where the emphasis was. And I think that's a much healthier emphasis to have than just, like, I'm going to hit this performance standard, but rather, like, I'm going to go after developing this gift this year, and I hope that it went in this spot, you know? And so, like, whatever we wrote in cement, like, we were just committed that we were going to go after it with everything we had. And it's just such a powerful way to kick off every year.
Well, I have to ask you, then what goal are you writing in cement today?
I have not written any goals in cement recently, but I do have, like, just fun kind of fitness goals. So I got into weightlifting and after I retired from professional running. And it's been really fun to just get stronger and stronger. And I'm not, like, strong by, like, strongman, like lifting competitions. Like, I would get destroyed in those. But I do have a goal. I'm 36 now, and I want to try and bench 405 pounds by the time I'm 40. So that's my current kind of fun goal to go after.
That's an incredible goal to go after.
Yeah. I'm at 315 right now, so
wow.
Still got ways to go, but just you know, like all goals, it's about just like baby steps and small gains over a long period of time. So like for my weightlifting, for example, I'm trying to get 5 pounds stronger every 2 months, and if I do that, I'll hit my goal. But like 5 pounds, that's like nothing, you know. You're like, why do you need to work out for 2 months to get stronger? But like, that's reality. Like, it, like, change takes time, you know, and you gotta put in the work and the time, and the, you gotta have the patience to let that change manifest itself.
So, so true. And I actually wish more people would realize that, Ryan. In 2004, you had the hopes of competing in the Olympic trials and the Olympic Games. Following that unsuccessful bid, though, because it didn't happen, there was a shift in regards to your goals.
Yes. Yeah, I went from, I had a countdown in my dorm room at Stanford to the 2004 Olympics, and as you mentioned, didn't make it to that. And so, like, through that experience, and I write about this in the book, I had to come up with goals that were more, like, I can achieve this every time out. Because I was sick of, like, setting all these performance goals and, like, doing everything in my power to achieve those and coming up short. Like, this isn't much fun to, like, be going after something that, like, at the end of the day, I don't have control of if I achieve this goal or not. So that's kind of when, like, goals began to shift. I stopped doing the countdown to the Olympics. I stopped writing times down as much, you know. And I think there's a time and place that, like, have time goals. And like I was talking about with lifting and numbers, like, I think those are okay if they're in the context of, like, a healthy view of priorities and goals and how you should view those goals. But what I found is that I had to have a goal that, staying on the starting line of every race, I knew I could accomplish it every single time out. And so those were kind of more philosophical goals because I couldn't guarantee I was going to run a certain time or finish in a certain place. But I could guarantee, like, I'm going to run this race with as much joy as is inside of me. Like, I'm going to let all my joy out during this race. Or I'm going to focus this race on, like, loving people as much as I possibly can. Or I'm going to focus on this race on patience, and I'm going to be very controlled for the first half of the race and be very patient and then, like, let my energy come out, you know. So just kind of identifying, like, fun goals that I could get excited for, but goals that I knew that I can achieve it, you know, no matter how my body's performing on the day.
Well, and to think that when you are running a race, literally and figuratively, there is a finish line that you have to cross, and only one person will win that. I mean, because otherwise, if there's two that cross it, they measure down to the nth degree now with technology. So I love how you frame the whole idea that no matter what race you run, you're always a winner.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I struggle with most about sport is, like, part of me, like, doesn't want to even encourage, like, if I was talking to my 13-year-old self, if the goal is to be the best guy in the world and that's the definition of success, like, I wouldn't encourage myself to pursue that because the likelihood of that happening is just very, very small. And it doesn't matter, like, how hard I train or how much I believe or, like, there's, like, genetic components, there's people and how good other people are. Like, you just can't control that stuff. And so, like, I've just learned to, rather than, like, trying to beat other people or have performance goals, have my goal be more about excellence. You know, like, I can always develop my gift to the fullest ability. And that's really what my career is about, was, like, finding my own personal excellence and even using, like, my competitors to try and encourage them to draw out their excellence so they could find something that otherwise wouldn't be there if I wasn't in the race, and vice versa, you know, using those guys to pull me along and help me run faster than I could run. That kind of became, like, the driving force of my running.
Wow. Well, I know everyone is intrigued and they're going to want to pick up their own copy of Run the Mile You're In, Finding God in Every Step. Well, not only do we have winning in life, but we also have failures. And in life, we all experience those failures. You experience them as an athlete, as a coach, as a dad, me as a mom. You write in your book that athletes need to develop amnesia about their poor performances.
Yeah, that was something that I heard from a sports psychologist. I think he was, like, on the sports radio or something. He was talking about needing to develop sports amnesia to your poor performances. And I was like, man, that's so powerful, you know, because you see that all the time in sports where I'd be around highly, highly successful athletes. And when they perform bad, they were usually pinning it on other people, or not so much other people, other factors besides themselves, you know. But that was kind of a way for them to, like, still be able to believe in themselves, even though they had, you know, quote unquote failed. So I think, like, we got to adopt the same kind of mindset and yeah, have the failures not define us, you know? Because I know for myself, like, I would take my failures very personally, and, like, it's like I saw myself as a failure because I failed. But I had to learn to separate those two things. Like, what do I see is not a result of my performances. I had to move past that.
That's very, very, very powerful. And I hope that those who are listening and watching really will grasp that, especially those who have younger children. And we're all in it for them to win it every single time. Winning needs to take a different look. And I love just that whole, you know, framework of really creating that amnesia for poor performances. Well, what poor performance taught you the most about yourself?
You know, the one that comes to my mind initially, one that people might not see as necessarily a poor performance, but because of my own expectations, I saw it as a poor performance, was the Beijing Olympic Games. You know, I had run 2:06 leading up to that race and had finished, I believe I was fifth at the London Marathon, where I just raced the best guys in the world. So, you know, I had a very good chance of podiuming, getting in the top three at the Olympics, you know, getting a medal, which is what you want to do. So, well, what most people want to do at the Olympics. And I remember and I write about this in my book, doing my pre-race run in the Olympic Village. There's a little, like, trail that's, like, a mile around it. And I remember just doing an easy jog and kind of asking God for a word for my race tomorrow. And I felt like he reminded me of the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and how when they're talking to the king before he threw them in the furnace, their resoluteness to, even if God didn't show up, they weren't going to bow down and worship the false Nebuchadnezzar. And I just found that to be so powerful, that, like, beforehand, like, they were determined, like, even if God doesn't show up how I want to, even if he doesn't deliver me and save my life, like, I'm still going to worship him the same. And that was so powerful for me to take the next day into the Olympic marathon, because, you know, I had my own expectations of how I wanted God to show up, and he didn't show up the way that I wanted him to. You know, it wasn't the easiest race I ever ran in my life. There was no supernatural, like, floating along. It was a very hard, grindy, disappointing race up until about the halfway point, where I was sitting back and I don't even remember exactly what place I was in, maybe 50th, 60th place, and just pouting to God, you know, just being like, what's going on? I'm so frustrated. Why is this happening to me on the biggest day of my life, you know? And I felt like God started telling me, like, I want you to start encouraging other people around you. And that was changed the rest of my race, because every time I'd catch a guy, I'd just say a couple of words to try and encourage him, which doesn't typically happen in elite marathoning. And as I did that, I found that it just kind of encouraged my spirit, and it allowed me to get off outside of myself, because oftentimes when I'm suffering, I'm focused on myself, and all my thoughts become intrinsic. I'm just thinking about the sensations I'm experiencing. And then when I start encouraging other people, my thoughts go towards those people, and I'm able to get outside myself, and then my body starts to perform better because I'm less aware of the pain that I'm suffering. So, you know, it didn't completely change, and I didn't run and make it onto the podium as a result of that, but I did work myself back in 10th position and kind of battle through, like, a very tough internal mental battle that was taking place within the middle of the race for me. And I think, you know, looking back on it now, I can see it was a huge success, even though, you know, I was 10th place and not on the podium.
10th place in the entire world, I'm just saying. I mean, that's more than I will ever accomplish. Well, in your book, though, you do write about that, and I love what you said. You said competing out of love results in superior strength.
Yes, and that's just I think I wrote about this in the book as well. Like, I remember doing an experiment when I was a kid where you put your arm out, and then they tell you to think about someone or something that you hate, and then they push down on your arm to see how strong you can resist. And then they have you do the same exact thing, but this time think about someone you love, and you're so much stronger when you're thinking about love. And I just feel like that's just how God made our bodies to work, you know? Like, it says in the Bible that God is love, and we're created in his image. And so, like, in a way, we are also at our best when we're functioning in love, in his likeness, which is love, you know? And so it can be hard to develop that mindset in today's culture, because a lot of athletes are motivated by beating other people or fear of failure and those things. And those, I'm not saying those are not motivators. I'm just saying that the more powerful motivator is love. The more effective motivator is love. I just have experienced that throughout my career, like, where I would be in the middle of these races and just suffering really, really bad. And I would be looking into the TV, you know, they're filming us on the back of a motorcycle. I'm looking into the camera, and I'm thinking about all my loved ones that are either home or back at the start watching me run through the television lens, and just thinking about how much I love them, how much I appreciate their support on my journey, you know. And just as I think those thoughts of love, I find that I can find gears that I didn't know were there.
We need more of those gears in life, and I wish we had more of them. However, we get trapped in something called comparison. You have a whole chapter on this, and in fact, in your book, because y'all are going to pick up your own copy of Run the Mile You're In, Finding God in Every Step. And what I love about how you set this book up, Ryan, is that each chapter is a mile. And I was just like, how cool is that? We're literally running a marathon with Ryan. And so I know when you guys pick up your own copy, you're going to mark it up like I have completely here. But I really think that it's one that you don't have to start from the beginning and go to the end. You can pick wherever you are and come back to it. And so I really think it's a daily use book. You know, I read it from front to back, loved it. But now I know that, hey, I'm sending my kids to chapter 10, or I'm sending my husband to chapter 21, whatever it is, or me to chapter 1 because of what it is, that mile. And so, Ryan, hats off to you on how you set that up. I think it's absolutely splendid. Well, so back to compare. Oh, you're welcome. Well, so back to comparison, because we talked about love, and now, you know, with comparison, it really eats at us. And in a world that we're so connected with technology, I mean, look at us. You're in a totally different state than I am. We're hundreds of miles away from each other, but we get to chat like this. You would have never had that 20 years ago when you started running in your journey as a pro athlete. You say winning can be fun, but can be a poisonous comparison. How does one overcome comparison?
Yeah, that's, you know, all the lessons that I wrote, you know, every chapter is kind of like a big lesson that God taught me. They're all things I struggled with, you know, and had to overcome. And this was a big, big thing for me. You know, I grew up in the middle of five kids. And, you know, middle child syndrome, they're trying to, like, stick out, right? They're trying to, like, set themselves apart from their siblings. And so, you know, I think I kind of fell into that, you know. So from the time I was a little tiny kid, I was always trying to, what makes me special? What makes me pop? What sets me apart in relation to everyone else? And just really, like, comparison, competitiveness was a big part of, like, how people would probably describe me as, like, competitive. And I had to learn to kind of shift that, because I found it was just very unfulfilling, and that I would not continue on the journey if it was all about how I stacked up relative to other people, or even how I stacked up relative to my own previous performances. It just took all the fun out of sports, because I was just a mess all the time. Because, you know, you don't PR very often, especially, like, as you're getting faster and faster. Like, improving gets to be very difficult. So if it's all about improving and running faster than you've ever run before, like, you're going to end up disappointed almost all the time. And I don't want to do anything where I'm that's not life-giving to me, you know. And sports are supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be life-giving. It's supposed to teach us these lessons. So, yeah, I had to fall back on that all the time. Like, I'm not going to compare myself to other people. And what really freed me was this passage in the Bible where I believe it's the end of John, like John chapter 21. And Jesus is talking to Peter and telling Peter how he's going to die. So, like, a super heavy subject, you know. And Peter's response to Jesus after he tells him how he's going to die is, well, what about him? And he points to John the disciple. And he's like, how is he going to die? And Jesus says, if I want him to remain till the end, what is that to you? You follow me. And that, like, you follow me just, like, grabbed my heart, because it's so convicting for me. Because I was like, I'm so distracted by what God has for other people, or how fast other people are running, or what place I was relative to everyone else. I'm not just focused on, like, you follow me, you follow Jesus. Like, just look at Jesus, who's right in front of you, and stay as close to him as you can. Like, that is the goal. That is victory, you know? And so that passage really grabbed me and really kind of changed my perspective on comparison, and kind of flipped my view into, well, I'm going to go after excellence. I'm not going to go after trying to beat people, even though I'm a professional athlete, and that's, like, the standard that I'm held to, but that's not my personal standard that I'm going to subscribe to. Like, I'm subscribing to going after excellence.
Amen. Hallelujah. Preach on, brother. I love it. It gets me excited. But okay, so now we've talked about failures, we've talked about comparison, we've talked a little bit about winning. Now we got to talk about an elephant in the room called doubt. And I think all of us carry doubt, especially when it's one that as Christians, we're like, I want to live out what God is calling me to do. And it can put a true cloud over our dreams and really where we feel like God wants us. What do you say to those who are doubting their calling?
I would say the words that my dad told me when I was a little kid, and I didn't even write about this in the book. I wish I would have now, but that's why I'm glad that we get to have these conversations to kind of expand on it, is to doubt your doubt. Like, he would tell me that all the time, and I would just constantly go back to that, because I'm like, this probably isn't true, but like I'm really having this thought at this moment, you know. And I do write about it in the book, and being at mile 12 of the Philadelphia half marathon with a group, being in the group of a lead group of Kenyan athletes, and feeling like God was reminding me of the verse that says, as a man thinks in his mind, so he is. And that just really kind of like brought me back to, what do I believe about, what thoughts am I thinking? And so like I just like, even though I didn't feel like I could speed up, I just pounded myself with this thought of like, when I hit 1 mile to go, like I'm gonna accelerate, you know. And I just kept telling myself that over and over again, even though I felt super tired and I didn't feel like that was, like inside of me, there was doubt there. You know, I was like, I don't know if this is actually going to happen, but I'm going to keep pummeling myself with this thought. And as I did that, like when I got 2 miles to go, it was like just a natural reaction. It didn't take a whole lot of effort. And I was just shocked by like how much energy I had over that last mile. I think I ran somewhere around 4:20 something or other for that last mile. But that never happened if I had not had that thought. So, you know, there's a reason why like the Bible tells us to take every thought captive, because our thoughts are so powerful. What we believe about ourselves is so powerful, and something that like I'm constantly working on, like I need to get better at this as well. Like it's not, I haven't experienced it to be like a one-time thing where it's like, okay, I'm gonna start thinking positive thoughts and then never have to like work on it again. It's like, no, it's like these thoughts are always coming up, and what I've kind of learned to do with those negative thoughts is to flip them around, use them as cues to declare the opposite of those thoughts. So like, for example, if I'm telling myself like I'm not very good at cooking or something, because I'm currently struggling with like coming up with good meals that are actually edible to make for my kids, but instead of like telling myself like, oh, I'm terrible at cooking, like use that as a cue to encourage myself and be like, I'm currently struggling with cooking, but I'm going to find supernatural creativity to create meals that are actually edible, you know? So just using those to like declare the opposite of the doubt that I'm experiencing in my mind.
We need those declarations to really flip it. And some people think, oh, it's all about positive thinking. There's more than just positive thinking. And in your book, I can really see a pattern with you, how you kept a discipline throughout your ups and downs.
Yeah, and the discipline came from just love of the pursuit, you know? It's like when I had that vision to run with the best guys in the world, like it just totally changed me from someone who hated to run to someone who was just like in love with the journey of going after this big goal, you know? So like if you're struggling with discipline, I just encourage you, and I encourage myself with this as well, because there's other areas that discipline is a lot harder for me. But it's to fall in love with like the pursuit and the journey, and make your discipline flow out of that love for the journey.
I love that. And I also love, though, how as you continued your journey from the beginning to the end, and how, you know, God really showed up in your life still within your journey, which is not over yet. I mean, you've got a lot more years. I pray you have a lot more years. God has a lot more plans, I'm sure, for you. But it really, your journey in running specifically really helped in your prayer life and your relationship with God.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the two were always intertwined, like vines that, you know, are crisscrossing, like God and my running were just like that. Like, I'm so grateful. I think that's true for a lot of us, where like we experience God within our passions, because he's the one who gave us those passions. And so, like, for me, sometimes sitting in my room, just quietly trying to, like, prayer journal, like, that works sometimes, but not all the time. Like, sometimes I find it much easier to connect with God when I'm actually doing, like, things that he's gifted me to do, you know? And so, yeah, my faith, it spills over into my running, and that's something I believe very strongly in, too, that, like, if we apply biblical principles, like, to all areas of our life, whether it's business or running or whatever it might be, like it's going to work, because those are like principles that like God set in creation from the time of creation. Like that's how he made us. That's how he made the planet to work. So I'm always like digging through the Bible, just looking for like principles just to live by. Like, yeah.
For those that have a dream to go out and possibly be an Olympic athlete, or for those who had a dream and are too old to be an Olympic athlete ever in the remainder of their life, what is it like to live out your God-given talents on such a global stage?
Yeah, it was an amazing experience. You know, I always tell people running into the Beijing Olympic Stadium was the moment that, you know, I'll never forget the rest of my life. I felt like it was a taste of heaven, you know, like the whole time out there running the marathon, the course is crowded with people, it's super loud out there, it's hard to even hear yourself think. And then all of a sudden you go into this tunnel and there's literally no one in there. It's just quiet. And all you hear is the pitter patter of your feet. But then you start to hear and feel the vibration of the crowd in the stadium that's awaiting you. And then you pop out and there's just, you know, hundreds of thousands of people just going crazy yelling. And it's such a, you know, and from every nation, every type of person is there. And I just feel like, man, this is like a little taste of heaven. Like, this is what it's going to feel like when we're all together and, you know, finally with God in heaven.
That is so beautiful. And I love how you say it, that you come out and it's just you, and then all of a sudden you're consumed by the nations. And surely that's what's going to, you know, it's going to be like that when the gates of heaven are opened and we're all called home. What an incredible homecoming that will be. Well, Ryan, you've had an absolutely incredible career, but not all of them were wins. What lessons have you learned that did not result in a victory across the finish line?
Yeah, I think, you know, one that's easy to pull out from my career was when I decided to leave the Mammoth Track Club. And so this was in 2010. I had been running professionally for about 5 years after graduating from Stanford. And, you know, I had great success, loved my coach, loved my teammates, loved being a Mammoth. Like, nothing bad to say about that experience, you know. But I felt like God was kind of leading me into a position where I needed to be desperate to hear God's voice every single day. And I wanted to deepen my faith and deepen my connection with God. So I went out on this like faith-based coaching and initially had just tons of success right off the bat. Ran 204 at the Boston Marathon, then 208 in Chicago, made my second Olympic team. All of that was like on faith-based coaching. But then from 2012 onward, it was just navigating the struggles. Navigating injury after injury, disappointment after disappointment, you know, signing up for marathon after marathon and not even making it to the starting line because of injuries, fatigue, just from my body just not cooperating, you know. So that was definitely seen as a huge failure, I think, in the public eye. But for me, living it, like, I just experienced God in such sweet ways during that time. And I feel like he helped me navigate the trickiest season of my life. So, you know, I think we experience the kindness, the gentleness, the leading of God in a very special way when we're going through those valley experiences.
Wow. Okay, everybody needs to just stop for a moment and rewind and listen to all of that again, because that hits the heart. But it also hits the mind. And then when you begin to comprehend what you said, Ryan, it just like, I mean, it gave me chills from top to bottom. And I think when we realize that there's more to winning in life, that we realize that our purpose is much bigger and we can go out and live it a lot easier. And the struggle doesn't necessarily become less, but it becomes more doable.
Yeah, and I write about that a little bit in the closing chapter when I'm talking about, like, knowing that you've already won. Like, you've already got the most amazing thing you could possibly have in life. Like, if you've accepted Jesus' free gift that he offers to everyone and you're in relationship with God, like, there's nothing better you can have in life. And I have to remind myself of that all the time because it's so easy to take it for granted. But that's just, like, when you really sit down and think about it, like, man, that is it. That's the gold medal, that we can all have it, though. It's not just one person, you know. And that just frees us. And that's my experience as a Christian athlete, that we can compete totally free from performance burdens, from pressures, like all the things that I've experienced that bogged me down in my career. Like, I could get free of that just with this one reality that I already have the gold medal, and that gold medal is knowing Jesus. And if I have that, then I can be on the starting line, and I can just let it all ride fearlessly. I can take risks, I can take chances, and it's not going to work every time, but like, I'm okay with failure because I know I've already won.
Wow. Well, you're a winner in my eyes. And I know everybody else will think the same, because they're going to pick up their own copy of Run the Mile You're In, Finding God in Every Step. I'm telling you, this is something, honestly, you've got graduation coming up around the corner, whether they're graduating from high school, maybe it's even middle school into high school, college graduation. This would be a great gift. I'm just putting it out there, because you got to think beyond your own world. And sometimes we get caught up in our own stuff. And so I want to, you know, remind you all that if you've got a graduate, pick this copy up for them too, and write something meaningful in there. In fact, Ryan, what is one of your favorite Bible verses?
So one of my very favorites I talk about in the book is, though a righteous man falls seven times, he rises again. And the reason why I love that verse so much is because it gets to the issue of identity. And so, like, what is it that allows us to get back up when we've fallen over and over and over again? And you think about the verse, you're like, hold on a second, like, righteous people aren't supposed to fall, right? Like, that's what makes them righteous. But it's actually, like, it's their identity as seeing themselves as righteous that allows them to get back up. And that's true of us as Christians. You know, like, we are not perfect people and we do fall, but when we are reminded of who we are and that we are in right standing with God because of Jesus' free gift to us, knowing that is our nature now. Like, we're no longer sinners. We are seen as righteous in the eyes of God. Like, that's what allows us to get back up, because our identity is firm in who we are.
Wow. Well, when people pick up their own copy, what do you hope that they will gain as they read it?
Yeah, I just hope that, you know, they can just pull out a couple nuggets. And I think, you know, this is probably a book where certain chapters resonate more with some people than others, you know, but I just really want to encourage people. I really hope that my story can help people on their journey and help them to get to their destination and their God-given potential through learning from my own personal experiences. So I just hope it encourages people. I hope that people feel loved when they read it, and I hope that they feel like they're getting, you know, a very honest insight into who I am and the things I've learned on my journey.
Well, it is a beautiful insight. In fact, there's a lot of cool stories in here, and we would be here for hours if we talked about them all. I just want to leave a teaser, though. The teaser is this. You talk about running seven marathons in 7 days on seven continents. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to tell you how the story ends or what he may be leaving at the finish line, but you'll have to pick up your own copy of Run the Mile You're In, Finding God in Every Step. Well, I know people are going to want to connect with you, Ryan, and I could literally have you here all day. You're cut from an extraordinary cloth, and God did good when he created you, and I'm so glad that you really tapped in to your purpose, and now you're sharing that as a coach. But when people, they're going to be saying, I want my kid to meet this dude, or they're going to want to read your blog or get more information, where can they find you?
Yeah, so you can find me on Instagram and Twitter. My handle is RyanHall3. And then my wife and I, we also have a website, RyanAndSarahHall.com. So those are, yeah, the best ways to find us.
Well, we'll be sure to have all that information in the show notes so you all can readily have it accessible to you. Because you might be working out, you might be running, whatever you're doing, cooking dinner. Maybe you need to send a recipe to Ryan so he has some good, easy meals to fix for his daughters. But regardless, I have one last question, Ryan, before I let you go. The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
Ooh, that's a good one. My story has gifted me resilience, for sure, without a doubt. Like, I mean, we've talked a lot about in this conversation, just how many failures I've had to overcome, how many times I've had to pick myself back up. You know, I'm a big dreamer, And as a big dreamer, you have to develop your resilience because there's going to be a lot of failure along the way. At least that's my own personal experience.
Well, you may have had a lot of failures, but you also have a lot of successes too. And I know many more to come. I am so ecstatic that you took time to join us and to share your story. I know it will bless many people out there. And I look forward to having you back on.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. I really enjoyed our conversation.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.